You know, as a historian, there's raging debates. If you can imagine historians having raging debates. When do we start this conversation of a civil rights movement? Obviously, we could start for the modern civil rights movement in 1954 with Brown. Brown is oftentimes an important bookend because it gives civil rights activists one fundamental legal tool in their tool belt, which is the system of Jim Crow had been found unconstitutional, specific to segregated education. So the question then still gnaws at us a little bit. Well, we know that there were challenges and issues prior to, so 1954 can't be the only beginning. And so for teaching purposes, part of what I like to do and what I've learn from others along the way is to think through the various initiation points for what might be considered the modern civil rights movement. And then that ultimately gets us understanding and recognizing that it's been a long movement for Black equality, a long Black freedom struggle that has had various upsurges around various issues in various locales at different points. And so we could begin this conversation in 1954. Obviously, that makes perfect sense for the 50s and 60s, that moment. We could also begin the conversation around the civil rights movement in the 50s and 60s, beginning somewhere right around or immediately after World War II. World War II reshapes American expectations, both domestically and internationally. We come out of World War II with a different set of expectations from our government. We also have internationally a very rich set of conversations around fascism and fighting fascism. And obviously in the United States, if we're running around the globe telling folks to not be fascists in other parts of the country, then African Americans very astutely said, well, how about not being racial fascists here in our own country? So the World War II era mobilization is also an important moment to think about what might have been an initiation point. I like to go back also into the 1920s with what we often refer to as the Harlem Renaissance, the New Negro Movement. There's certainly very important articulations around Black identity and what equality ought to look like that's central in the 1920s. You also have the Garvey Movement in the 1920s, which helps to lay the foundation for a whole range of radical expressions in succeeding decades. We could go to the late 1880s, 1890s, when we see the first major outcomes of folks migrating to different parts of the US from outside of the South and beginning to reshape various regions around the country. Indeed, Brooke, you already knew where I was headed. For my own interest, I like to start the conversation about the civil rights movement of the 1950s and 60s in 1865. I absolutely begin our conversation in 1865 because of the 13th Amendment. What does it mean that 3+ million, or almost 4 million African Americans are no longer enslaved? Slavery is no longer legal in the, well, I shouldn't say it that way. The institution of slavery is eradicated except as punishment for a crime. It's fun to play with the 13th Amendment. So take a peek at the 13th Amendment if you haven't had a chance to review it. I like to start that conversation around the 13th Amendment with one fundamental question. Is slavery against the law? It is not against the law. And the 13th Amendment says it very clearly. Except as punishment for a crime. Neither slavery nor involuntary servitude shall exist except as punishment for a crime. The 14th Amendment is critical, right? Equal protection, due process, birthright citizenship. I like to always encourage students to understand that they know the 14th Amendment, whether they can recite it or not. We understand as a nation, as people, we understand some very fundamental rights of citizenship that are enshrined in the 14th Amendment. I don't know whether it's because we watch a lot of Law and Order. I'm not sure why. But when you say the words equal protection, due process, birthright citizenship, naturalization, young people most folks understand those ideas. Most people have some understanding of that. And of course, the 15th Amendment, which actually doesn't give an affirmative right to vote, but does suggest and state that voting can't be denied on account of race. So Reconstruction is critical. 13th, 14th, 15th Amendments is a constitutional revolution. And of course, we know that there is some unfinished business from America's first Reconstruction of the 1860s and 70s that then leads us into Jim Crow, but then also is quite informative in terms of what occurs in the 1950s and 60s. I'm not sure what just happened there. I got an interesting thing happening on my computer here, folks. So when we start the movement for Black equality, whether that is 1950s and 60s or as far back as the 1860s, we could also push that conversation back to the first time an African resisted slavery. You know, we could go back as far as we want to define some beginning points. And so as we think about teaching this with our young people, give plenty of room and latitude to think about how this movement has been indeed a long movement with various upsurges and key moments to inform that process. Let's keep going. I know, Adam, I got to hurry up. Adam is looking at me across the computer. I can't actually see him, but I'm sure he's looking at me like, hurry up, it's my turn. I got a couple more
points. I'm editing out some stuff.
Oh, okay. Next point, it's been a movement of local movements. It's tempting and it's very flirtatious to think that this was a national agenda that everybody kind of just fell in line behind, and everybody who wanted to be a part of these protest communities, it was a neatly shared set of expectations and values and practices. Indeed, as we know, social movements are complicated. Social movements are messy. Social movements are all the different words we can come up with. But what really holds this thing together is the rich, brilliant expressions of local activism. This has been a long movement, but it has been a movement of local movements. We can go across the country and we can see in any major city, in many locales, all kinds of expressions of folks working to secure just a modicum of equality and human dignity. So as much as this movement has been long, it's been wide. It's stretched across our nation. And as we move into local movements, it's been deep. These very important issues at the local level have to be challenged by local people because they're the ones who are most astute about the realities on the ground there. And as you see here on this slide, there are some voices and some faces here who are sort of emblematic of the importance of local movement. Robert Williams here, Ella Baker, who in many respects is sort of the key organizer of organizers. And then of course, March on Washington program, if you take a peek at that, that is a rich, rich document that outlines all the folks who offer some commentary. But this has been a movement of local movements. The local has been absolutely critical. And I wanna make sure to keep folks involved. We still got 28 people in on the call. Adam, that's a good sign, 30 minutes in. How about you all give us again some of those local movements just one more time? I know we went through some of them before. Greensboro, Albany, we should probably include Atlanta. There's some other southern cities that ought to be included. Nashville, you got to include Detroit, Little Rock, absolutely. Leslie, thank you. Charlotte, North Carolina, yes, Charlotte. I used to live in Charlotte. I mentioned North Carolina, there's a rich history there. Detroit, Revolutionary Union Movement, Chicago, Cleveland, you know. Obviously, you can go across the country and find a whole wide array of local movements that then brings together this thing we might call a long Black freedom struggle, or if we stay in the 50s and 60s, the civil rights movement. Thank you, folks, for taking part. Let's go to the next slide, Adam, so I can get you into this conversation. And the last component to this that I'd like to share in terms of framing, and I think this is really critical for our young people, we have to emphasize this over and over and over. Nothing in this country of significance has changed until young people got into the mix. and that's probably a bit of an overstatement, but I think we can go with that. Young people have played a central role in social change. You have here Diane Nash and the folks from SNCC. You have the first four young men who sat in at the Woolworth counter. You have the three slain civil rights workers. You have some images here on this slide that reminds us how young people were, how young folks were in making sure to engage the question of equality. And young people are critical for all kinds of reasons. Snapping here at home, I promise. I appreciate it, Tanya. Young people are critical for a number of reasons, but one particular reason young people are critical to social change is because young people are crazy. You know, young people, they're brave. They don't have any real sense of how fragile life might be. And yet the young people who made up the movement in the 1950s and 60s, they learned those lessons all too seriously. They came to understand that they were literally putting their lives on the line to make society just a little bit better. They didn't want to wait for some version of equality down the road. Oh, really? Keisha's grandfather was a World War protester. That's awesome. They don't want to wait for equality. You know, older folks, we'll sit down and we'll talk about it. We'll have a meeting. How many meetings have we all been sitting in the last 6 or 8 weeks dealing with online stuff? But young people don't want to wait. Young people want their rights today. They want what they're entitled to immediately. And it's a very important radicalizing moment when young people engage in issues. And so we wanted to also highlight that you can still see the vibrant imprint of youth and youth culture, whether it's through hip hop. Shouts to the Roots. Can I give props to the Roots, the legendary Roots crew? Thank you, folks. I appreciate it. The impact of punk music and culture, right? The just recently, the March for Our Lives, the way young people demanded that the United States do something about gun violence. You know, these are expressions of youth culture that have continued to play a role in pushing us in our society. They are not afraid of failing. That's absolutely right, Davis. They are not afraid of failing. Young people push agendas in ways that as we get older, we become a little more complacent and a little more cautious, understandably, for a number of reasons. And that's not a knock or a critique. But young people have done some remarkable things for us, and they continue to do so. And particularly as we are educating our young folks, we have to remind them that we need them in all of these debates and all of these questions associated with equality. Their voice matters significantly. Okay, so that is a general framing for us, right? It's been a long movement. The civil rights movement of the 50s and 60s was intended to change the law. Youth play a central role in that process. We can begin this movement whenever we find some key touch points. Local movements are valuable and critical. And now what we like to do is transition us to Milwaukee. So use those four framing principles, ideas, to now help us become a little bit more informed and thoughtful about how we can understand the Milwaukee experience, the case study.